Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Hillsdale College's annual celebration of Constitution Day, marking the signing of the great document at the end of the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia, September 17, 1787. Of course, it's not the day that matters as much as the document itself, the right it secures and the blessings of liberty it secures. Unfortunately, most in this town, the Supreme Court, the Constitution, the President, don't make much of the Constitution, regardless of the day. Rather than bring our political life in line with our founding principles, the dominant view is that we should ignore our founding principles, perhaps reinterpret them, in order to transform our country into something very different. Hillsdale College, on the other hand, celebrates the Constitution and teaches the Constitution and upholds the Constitution every day, year in and year out, and we have done so since 1844. And we will continue to do so as long as we can, without government support, until they pry it out of our cold, dead hands. Good morning, I'm Matthew Spalding, Associate Vice President and Dean of Educational Programs for Hillsdale College here in Washington, D.C., where I oversee the Alan P. Kirby Center for Constitutional Studies and Citizenship, located on Capitol Hill. More about that in a brief moment. But first, although I will do more formal introductions this evening, I have the privilege to give you, for a welcoming comment, the current president of Hillsdale College, Larry Arn.
Good morning. So this is an academic celebration, which is an odd kind of thing, isn't it? It's academic because we're a teaching institution, very old, and we don't really know how to do anything else. So for us, we're like the hammer. Everything looks like a nail. And it's a celebration because back in the day when we were started, one of our four purposes, it's easy to say what they are, they're written in two beautiful paragraphs at the beginning of our Articles of Association, the founding document. One of them is high learning. That is to say, learning about things that are ultimate, things for the sake of which we live our lives. This conception appears in politics in America in the expression, the laws of nature and of nature's God. One of them is Christianity. John Dewey says that if you're an academic institution with Christian purposes, you are obliged to identify yourself as a propaganda institution. Our college is much older than John Dewey, and we think he's an idiot. One of them is morality. That is to say, good behavior and good character, the virtues of doing. To cultivate those virtues at Hillsdale College, our single most important institution is that we segregate our dormitories by sex. Which almost nobody does anymore, and which is at the point of becoming illegal to do. We will get to engage in civil disobedience. And the last one is freedom, and constitutional freedom, because you know, those high purposes that I just named, all three of the others, they're beyond politics. They're the purpose of all good politics. And of course, despotism doesn't like any of those institutions because they breed independence and the worship of things beyond us. So we celebrate this freedom that is protected best of all in history by the American Constitution for those deep institutional reasons. And of course, we're worried. Everybody is now. Anybody here not worried? Because please come and take the microphone if you. There's an agency in this city that has the power to regulate every financial credit transaction with a consumer in the land. And this agency is contrived so that the Congress is not able to oversee its budget. It is forbidden by statute, its own statute, signed by the president, you can guess which one, to look into the budget of this agency. The law that created this agency, the Dodd-Frank financial bill, says in its language that the agency is not to begin operation until its director is appointed. And then there was a filibuster on the appointing of a director, and so President Obama made a recess appointment, which has now been struck down as unconstitutional. Doesn't matter. The agency is thriving. The creator of that agency, the godmother of that agency, Elizabeth Warren, now a senator, then a Harvard law professor, is rumored to be about to join a presidential ticket. And think what it means when an agency of government is so sealed off from the political processes, which are the will of the people if they are able to be expressed at all. I know some people who work in this agency, and I can tell you they're very fine people. I trust those people. And yet, on the other hand, those people are not, to use the nomenclature of James Madison, angels. Should they have that power? We're living under a treaty. Is it a treaty, or is it an executive agreement? It's hard to tell. It's big. Six major, or formerly major, nations signed it, and the European Union signs it, and the United Nations Security Council signs it. It remakes the relations between what we used to think of as the West with the regional power that is strongest and most vile in a region full of vile powers. Some billions of money, or tens of billions of money, are freed up immediately for that nation. They must have it by now. This is done by agreement, or is it by treaty? It's actually kind of worse than just an agreement, because the Constitution says, the president shall have power by and with the advice and consent of the Senate to make treaties, provided 2/3 of the senators present concur. Now, this is Article 2, Section 2, Clause 2 of the Constitution of the United States, and Article 2 concerns the executive branch. And so that means that the Constitution, you know, does three things. It empowers, it limits, and it involves. So this can't be an empowerment thing. If it was an empowerment of the Senate, it would be in Article 1, where the legislature is dealt with. No, it's in Article 2. It's a restriction on the power of the president. And of course, that means then that if the president makes an agreement by himself with some power, then the next president holding the same power can undo it. But this is not like that, you see. Because they've actually, by a process that was contrived between the leaders in the Senate and the President of the United States, which means a bipartisan agreement, they actually reversed the Constitution. It doesn't take 2/3 to approve this massive thing. 1/3 can and has approved it. And so the argument will be, the next time something like this comes up, that this is how it's to work. But in addition, when it comes up that maybe we should undo this thing, it will be said that it is like a treaty, binding in the way that the Constitution binds. It's impossible to imagine a worse result. But I'm optimistic, and I'll tell you why. This is all so ugly and so stupid, and it does have the wide reputation of being simply out of control. And I said that the purpose of the Constitution was not just to empower and to limit, but also to involve. Who does it involve? The answer is us. To have a despotism, you can have just a simple law. Hitler's law was a short law called the Enabling Act. And all the Enabling Act said, it was passed by the processes under the Weimar Republic. And all it said was, the cabinet and the chancellor can do whatever the devil they please. And it was precisely the devil that it did please them to do. That's a short law and really simple. And after that, we can dispense with law. Whereas if a great nation and its people are to be in charge of the government, then they require constitutional forms by which they can give effect to their control. And if they are abandoned, then it is the people who are hurt. And I'm optimistic because it's been going on for a long time and it still hasn't won. And heroes before us who are also wise. We might meet somebody like that tonight, you never know. They fought and they won. Do you know what Winston Churchill's campaign slogan in the 1950 and 1951 elections were, in which he won, almost won the first one, did win the second one? The theme was socialism versus the people. Isn't that the argument? And I don't mean that it's socialism now, it's something different, it's bureaucracy. A nifty form of socialism. And that's a very great power. But it is opposed, ultimately, to the control by the people of their own lives. Let's celebrate the return of that control.
If our panel would go ahead and make their way up. I mentioned a moment ago that I have the privilege of overseeing the Alan P. Kirby Center for Constitutionalized and Citizenship, our campus here in Washington, D.C. Hillsdale College was founded in 1844 by men and women grateful to God for the inestimable blessings of civil and religious liberty and intellectual piety throughout the land. They believe in so founded a college to provide for the sound learning essential to perpetuate those blessings. The practice of constitutionalism requires the moral and intellectual virtues cultivated by liberal education and in turn cultivate those virtues in our citizens. Hillsdale College has an important thing to teach, things not readily understood in this town about America and its experiment in constitutional liberty, and about the principles that inform that idea and the self-governing regime that has grown up around them. About the laws of nature and nature's God, about the self-evident truths of human equality, about consent to the governed, and the constitutional forms to secure the rights of our nature. It has something to say about this new bureaucratic form of government that is increasingly ruling us and which threatens our liberty. Until we understand that, until we understand where we are, whither we are attending, as Lincoln put it, we cannot know what to do about it. So the purpose of the Kirby Center here in Washington is to extend the college's teaching mission to the nation's capital and beyond by teaching students, citizens, and political leaders about the principles and practices of American constitutionalism, how to understand and how to apply them. Through classes and lectures, seminars and retreats, we teach students, undergraduates, graduate students for sure, congressional staff and members of Congress, God knows they need the education, about those principles and how to think about them in today's politics. Some of you are coming to the Kirby Center this afternoon. I encourage you to visit. But this panel is about conservatism, or more precisely, how conservatives, those who wish to conserve the American idea of fundamental rights, limited government, self-rule and independence, a thriving civil society and unlimited opportunity, how conservatives should proceed to advance those ideas in our politics. Easier said than done. I say our politics because conservatism at the same time that is principled has always been fundamentally prudent, recognizing practical realities and the necessities of politics in advancing those ideas. One need only think of Lincoln, or more recently, Ronald Reagan, both principled conservatives often prone to for good reason, compromise, accommodation. Of late, a number of thinkers have proposed the idea of reform conservatism. Not necessarily a reform of conservatism, but the argument that, of a need for a conservatism of reform. So here we are, 35 years after the Reagan Revolution. Do conservatives need to rethink their program, their ideas, their arguments? Can a conservatism be put together that will build a coalition, a principled coalition, but that can also attract the American people? Do we need to make adjustments? Can we do so without compromising our principles? How do we advance those ideas in a way that upholds constitutional principles, but in a way that does the practical work of politics, which is to say, brings the American people with you? So as we approach an election year, with practical politics in mind, and isn't this an interesting time of practical politics? With all of that in mind, but with our principles before us, let's take a broader view and talk first about the ideas and the principles and the solutions of conservatism and also American political thought. So we have a great panel this morning, three wonderful speakers, and I would like to introduce all three of them, and they'll speak in the following order. We begin with Ramesh Ponnuru. Ramesh is a senior editor at National Review, where he's covered national politics and policy for 20 years. At the magazine, as the editor, he oversees all the editorials that appear in the magazine and on its website. He's also a columnist for Bloomberg View, which syndicates his own articles in newspapers all across the country. And he recently joined the American Enterprise Institute as a visiting scholar. He's a contributing editor to National Affairs, and his articles appear widely in the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, the Washington Post. In 2014, he edited, along with Yuval Levin, a book, Room to Grow, Conservative Reforms for a Limited Government and a Thriving Middle Class. I note that because it's associated with, and his writing is largely associated with, this idea of reform conservatism. He will begin our conversation. He'll be followed by Shikha, who is senior policy analyst at the Reason Foundation in California. She's a columnist for The Daily, America's first iPad newspaper, writes regularly for Reason magazine, frequent contributor to the op-ed pages of the Wall Street Journal, as well as the Los Angeles Times, the New York Post, Weekly Standard, Chicago Tribune. She was previously a columnist for Forbes magazine, and the winner in 2009 of the first Bastiat Prize for online journalism. She frequently appears for Fox Business Network and lives in Detroit with her husband and son. And then lastly, our last speaker will be Stephen Hayward. Steve is the Ronald Reagan Distinguished Fellow, Distinguished Visiting Professor at Pepperdine University's Graduate School of Public Policy, and was the inaugural Visiting Scholar in Conservative Thought and Policy at the University of Colorado at Boulder. Prior to that, he was the Weyerhaeuser Fellow in Law and Economics at the American Enterprise Institute here in Washington, D.C., and Senior Fellow at the Pacific Research Institute in San Francisco. He also writes frequently, and you see his work in the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, National Review, Weekly Standard. You start to see a pattern in these writers. He's the author of six books, including a two-volume chronicle of Reagan and his times, entitled The Age of Reason, the Fall of the Old Liberal Order, 1964 to 1980, and The Age of Reagan, the Fall of Conservative Counter-Revolution, 1980 to 1989. So with that, I will turn it over to our first panelist, Ramesh Ponnuru of National Review.
Thank you, Matt, for having me here at Hillsdale's Celebrate the Constitution Day. I guess if we can't adhere to it, we can at least celebrate it. I was just telling Steve Hayward that we're actually putting an issue of National Review out today, and the hardest part of that is coming up with the opening line for the magazine. All this talk about the Constitution reminds me of what we said a little bit actually before my time. The first issue that came out after Bill Clinton's first inaugural in 1993, and our opening line was, "Don't let that oath of office scare you. the Constitution poses no serious threat to our form of government. And of course, now we look back sort of fondly at that presidency. It does seem to me that our constitutional decay, to keep with the cheery theme of this morning, has accelerated since then. I think it could be said with just a little bit of simplification that if the theme of President Obama's first term was an assault on limited government, the theme of his second term has been an assault on accountable government. And so the task of constitutional reclamation has never been more important. We conservatives believe in obeying the Constitution. We believe in it not just because it's the law, but because it's good law. The Constitution embodies a lot of wisdom about how we should be governed. It is conducive, if followed, to our own and our families and our communities and our nations thriving. What a conservatism of reform, to borrow Matt's felicitous phrase, proposes is that we make that practical case that adhering to constitutional government is not only the right thing to do, but it's good for us. And that we be prepared to make that case in some detail. It proposes, that is, that reclaiming the Constitution is not just about appointing the right judges, as important as that is, but it's about creating a successful, because an attractive, constitutionalist politics. Conservatism has generally excelled at propounding a philosophy of limited government. But it hasn't, especially in recent years, been quite as good at outlining an agenda that would be consistent with that philosophy and attractive to the public. By and large, conservatives have not presented an agenda that offered tangible advantages to many people or explained how it did so. Is this on the record? Are we being filmed? This is a small group of friends.
Nothing to worry about.
All right. In recent years, some conservatives have sometimes made a virtue of not presenting an agenda that would appeal to people on the basis of tangible rewards. I recall a presidential candidate who told me very boastfully that he was proud that he hadn't offered the American people any gifts in his campaign. He said that after his defeat. It seems to me there's something peculiar about a politics, and particularly, I think, conservative politics, that affects disdain for voter self-interest. And it's not a defect that is inherent to conservatism. Conservatives in the late 1970s and early 1980s made the case that the conservative agenda would make American life better for most people, that it would reduce crime, provide tax relief, end gas lines. This wasn't the whole of the conservative case, but it was an indispensable part of that case. And it seems to me that it remains indispensable today. And therefore, conservatives should identify public concerns, think through how we can address those concerns by applying conservative insights, and then argue for the resulting agenda. We should shrink government, and we should shrink it especially in the places and the ways where it would do the most good. And that, of course, depends on circumstances. Today, for example, it seems to me that reducing the federal role in healthcare and higher education ought to be much more central to the conservative agenda than it was in the early 1980s. Federal policies in both of these areas have been problematic in constitutional terms for many decades now, and without getting nearly enough attention from conservatives. But in recent years, both of those matters have become more pressing. Both sectors have become larger presences in our economy. Healthcare has seen a dramatic expansion of the federal managerial and indeed micromanagerial role. And higher education, as distorted by federal policies, has gone from being an engine of opportunity to something of a roadblock to it. In neither case, healthcare or higher education, does the cold turkey approach seem likely to work? You know, just end student loans, just get rid of all federal healthcare subsidies. But in both cases, there may be opportunities to move the federal government to a more modest and less destructive role, and we ought to identify and advocate for them. In healthcare, I think that should involve changing the tax breaks for health insurance and removing federal and state regulations in a way that allows a market for catastrophic health insurance finally to emerge. In higher education, it should mean a lot of things, among them allowing new institutions to get accredited and compete on a level playing field without having to be just like every other established institution of higher education. Both of those are places where I think conservatism could go a long way towards showing that our limited government philosophy is not just true in some abstract sense, but could make a positive difference in people's lives and in the life of the nation. Tax policy is another area where I think conservatives should try a different approach. At times in the past, it's been an area where conservatives have shown that limited government can make a real difference to most people by lightening their tax burden. But in the last few years, conservatives haven't really made that case, in part because of the misguided belief that most people aren't really burdened by taxes anymore, which is true only if you insist on a distinction between payroll taxes and income taxes that FDR invented to make life harder for limited government conservatives. Occupational licensing is another issue that ought to be moving up on our priority list because it's grown so much over the last 50 years. It's been doing more and more to close off opportunities. And there are many other issues where I think we can make a real difference. I could go on, believe me, that's not an empty threat. But I think I've illustrated the point that reform conservatism or reform-minded conservatism is a practical rather than a theoretical project. Most of us reform conservatives are very much conservatives rather than libertarians. But reform conservatism is not an attempt to supply an entire political philosophy as a rival to conservatism or libertarianism as we've known them. Instead, it's a practical project of identifying where and how we can apply our limited government principles in a way that solves pressing problems, and especially where conservatism has been too willing to be silent. It doesn't take the place, but rather complements other policies that are more familiar to conservatives, such as cutting the corporate tax rate or reining in the growth of entitlements. Conservatism always runs a risk because it rightly stresses its principles of abstraction and calcification. I think of another presidential candidate that I used to cover when I was first starting to write about national politics. He was a very good man, believes almost all the right things, but you got the impression, following him, listening to his stump speech, that if he were running for the premier of Albania in 1934, he would still be campaigning on a flat tax and pension privatization. If you compare that to the example of conservative statesmanship of Ronald Reagan, you see a very different pattern, where you have the application of conservative principles to the challenges of the time that he was campaigning in. So against Soviet adventurism, he proposed an ideological competition and a military buildup. Against gas lines, he proposed deregulation of prices. Against stagflation, he proposed monetary restraint and tax rate reduction. While the circumstances of those days are gone now, we've changed those circumstances partly because of the success of the Reagan program, and we need to apply our principles anew to the challenges that a different generation faces. It is entirely possible, probably even, that my fellow reform conservatives and I have not always applied them in the most sensible way. The particular policies we recommend may be wanting or insufficient in any number of ways. But I think we've rightly identified a gap in conservatism that needs filling and a task that needs doing. It's a task that was identified by the late Walter Burns as long ago as the late 1950s, when he said that our great and vital task is not to keep the Constitution in tunes with the time, but to keep the times in tune with the Constitution. That, I think, is our challenge. That, I think, is what we're going to do if we are going to have any success in righting our ship. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Matt. Thanks to Hillsdale College for having this wonderful panel. Thanks to Ramesh and to Steve for being here. This is Constitution Day is 2 days from now, and it is really a very important thing that Hillsdale has done to have devoted a panel to reform conservatism and its relationship to the Constitution. Now, if a movement can be judged by the amount of ink or bites it generates, reform conservatism must already be deemed a big success. It has barely reached its terrible twos, and nearly every major newspaper has already taken note of it. Long feature articles have been written about the movement, its aims, and its various figures that inhabit it. 8 million Google hits show up if you do an internet search. Reform conservatism has managed to generate intellectual excitement among conservatives after almost a decade-long hiatus. And reform conservatives like Ramesh and Peter Weiner and Yuval Levin and Ross Douthat and Rehan Salam have rightly come to be seen as the big ideas guys. It's always a pleasure and thought-provoking to read them. But here's the curious thing. Although this coverage has been largely positive and even glowing in the center-left press, it has been largely cautious, even suspicious in the center-right press. With the exception of Salon's Michael Lind and few others, liberal writers such as E.J. Dion, Jonathan Chait, Peter Beinart have praised reform conservatism's stated goal of updating conservatism and adapting Reaganism to the 21st century. By contrast, on the conservative side of the political spectrum, one would be hard-pressed to find writers outside of the Reform Conservative Club itself, which is actually rather large, so it's not, you know, that says something, who are not disconcerted to some extent by its project. Entities as disparate as populist conservatives such as Rush Limbaugh and Breitbart's John Hayward, supply-siders such as Amity Schles, Wall Street Journal's Kimberly Strassel, classical liberals such as Ben Dominique, academic conservatives such as William Vogley at the Claremont Review, libertarians such as the Cato Institute's Jason Kuznicki, and of course, us hippies of the right at Reason, such as Nick Gillespie and myself. We are all rather uneasy with reform conservatism. All of us often disagree vehemently when it comes to immigration and various social issues, but we all seem to agree that the reform conservative proposal is at best a mixed bag. There is much to like in it and much to not, and for reasons of time, I'm afraid I'm going to have to focus more on the latter than the former. So what's our basic beef with reform conservatives? Not to put too fine a point on it, Ramesh's statements about reclaiming the Constitution notwithstanding, they seem to be constitutional squishes when it comes to limited government and the welfare state. Their own, so you know, when Ramesh said, if we cannot adhere to the Constitution, let's celebrate it, that's actually kind of accurate. I think that's pretty perceptive. They seem to have a far greater comfort level with an activist redistributive government that promotes the interest of a favored class, namely the middle class, to achieve predetermined social ends, namely strengthening middle class families. To be sure, as Jonathan Chait has noted, reform conservative writings tend to generally begin with very elaborately crafted denunciations of big government, liberalism, and the Obama administration. But as Chait argues, and by the way, Ramesh is his favorite reform conservative, and with good reason, Ramesh does really excellent work, this often seems like rhetoric to prove their partisan bona fides because their ends don't seem to be at all at odds with the broader liberal agenda. I think Chait has a point. Reform conservatives' primary political objective is not to make government in all its forms small enough to drown in a bathtub, in the immortal words of Gruber Norquist. They see government as a toolbox that they want to keep handy to pull out implements such as tax credits, vouchers, tariffs, and federal spending to enhance middle-class welfare. Indeed, Rehan Salam recently commented to the New York Times' Josh Barrow that what Trump's rise proves is that conservative voters are open to, and this is a quote, government programs that help the right people. And that does seem to be exactly what reform conservatives are after. Their concern seems to be less with the size and scope of entitlement programs and more about directing them to the proper beneficiaries at the lowest possible cost. So their concern is about means, not so much about the ends. But the American Constitution is, in fact, more about the means than it is about the ends. And to help them achieve their ends, reform conservatives seem comfortable with downplaying the historic importance of, the limited government strain in America's constitutional conversation. And I wouldn't be a libertarian if I were not to bring that up today. The Ethics and Public Policy Center's Henry Olson, E.J. Dionne's favorite reform conservative, has argued that Romney lost the election in 2012 because he forgot a core constant in American politics, and I'm quoting, the willingness to use government power to help individuals advance in life. Olson, in fact, insists that if American principles simply require hands off government, then American principles have not been part of our politics for a very long time. A hands-off approach is not what American politics and principles require. It's a parody of what America and American conservatism mean. But that certainly would have come as news to Jefferson. He noted in the first inaugural, fellow citizens, a wise and frugal government, which shall restrain men from injuring one another, shall leave them otherwise free to regulate their own pursuits of industry and improvement, and shall not take from the mouth of labor the bread it has earned. This is the sum of good government. That sounds pretty hands-off to me. Jefferson also warned that the natural progress of things is for liberty to yield and government to gain ground. And nowhere is this truer than in the welfare state. Since this nation's inception, government has grown both incrementally and in dramatic spurts, as happened during the New Deal and the Great Society. Between the two, the New Deal represented a more comprehensive power grab. FDR advanced broadly what's both the regulatory state and the welfare state. Now, free market conservatives were able to partially roll back on the regulatory state by dismantling the National Recovery Administration and replacing the Wagner Act with the Taft-Hartley Act and repealing the Glass-Steagall Act. It took a long time, and we could never roll it back completely on all fronts, but we made gains. However, the welfare front is a different story. Far from beating back Social Security, we couldn't even prevent it from growing. It has become the untouchable third rail of American politics, along with the Great Society's Medicare and Medicaid. They were both sold as safety net schemes that would guarantee needy seniors and those with disabilities a minimum income level and health care, but they have both become giant entitlement programs. Reagan, who had once opposed Social Security, and I'm no expert on it, Stephen can correct me if I'm wrong, pledged his ironclad commitment to it once he was elected, even though he had opposed it originally, and raised payroll taxes to strengthen the program. George W. Bush added a prescription drug benefit to Medicare by enacting Part D. Both the regulatory state and the welfare state are liberal inventions. But the obvious reason why us limited government types have been able to push back against the excesses of the regulatory state, but have been less successful, with the exception of the 1996 Welfare Reform Act, about the excesses of the welfare state, is that individuals feel the pinch of the first, at least when the regulatory state is not hidden as part of industry mandates, but they enjoy the beneficence of the welfare state. The welfare state is more powerful because it is more insidious. Tocqueville had observed that America's democracy's spirit of freedom was too strong to succumb to outright tyranny, as in Europe. What he worried about was the soft despotism of the benevolent state that wants to do things for you, not to you. Yet the basic political bargain, seems to me, that the reform conservatives are putting on the table is that they want to scale back the regulatory state, by rolling back occupational licensing and all the other things that Ramesh mentioned, which I'm totally and fully on board with. But in their view, the main reason it impedes, because the regulatory state impedes the middle class. Never mind that the but on the other hand, they want to wrap up the welfare state because it helps the middle class. Never mind that the welfare programs right now consume about 70% of the budget. They want welfare reform, certainly, by bringing in market competition and choice and the private sector to help it make it more efficient and cost-effective. Yuval Levin has written with Hayekian eloquence about the self-dealing corruption, cronyism, and above all, the knowledge problems that characterize the welfare state run by a technocratic elite. Reform conservatives are certainly market-friendly in that sense, which is why there are many things to like and room to grow their policy manifesto, such as school vouchers for parents and healthcare tax deductions for households, not just employers. Completely and wholeheartedly agree with that. However, markets for them are ultimately, in my view, delivery tools for politically predetermined social ends, not necessarily discovery mechanisms for fulfilling individually determined needs, which was, you know, the F.A. Hayek's great message. Reformocons, therefore, often sound simultaneously both market-friendly and market-unfriendly. Now, the notion that conservatives are to make their peace with the welfare state is not new to reform conservatives. The godfather of neoconservatism, Irving Kristol, after all, declared in the early 1990s that the welfare state is with us for better or worse, and all we can seek is a welfare state consistent with the basic moral principles of our civilization and our nation. In fact, Kristol did not accept the welfare state simply because the right had lost the political battle, which was the position of Bill Buckley. He declared that neoconservatism doesn't have lingering hostility to the welfare state, nor does it accept it resignedly as a necessary evil. This is what they positively wanted. They believed in a positive welfare state, but they wanted it minimalist and they wanted it efficiently managed. Now, reform conservatives certainly agree with him on the efficiently managed part, hence their condemnations of technocracy and the need to inject market-style experimentation, evaluation, evolution, in the words of Yuval Levin. But the minimalist part has fallen by the wayside, in my view. Consider some of the programs that reform conservatives have supported, and this is by no means an exhaustive list. The most recent example that generated a lot of controversy is the $2,500 refundable child tax credit in the Rubio-Lee Economic Growth and Family Fairness Tax Reform Plan. This credit is on top of the $1,000 child credit that the tax code already affords, but unlike the existing credit, does not phase out with income, meaning that both Bill Gates and all of us here will be able to collect it equally. Moreover, it is refundable not only against income taxes, but also payroll taxes, and will cost about $173 billion annually, or about over $1 trillion over a decade. Now, the ostensible purpose of the tax, according to Robert Stein, also a reformocon in good standing, is to eliminate the double jeopardy on parents who have to raise children while paying for old age entitlements. He believes that without this, there is just too much of a disincentive to having children. So this tax is, in some senses, an effort to boost fertility rates and produce the future workers needed to sustain Social Security and Medicare. In other words, instead of entitlement programs serving the population that exists, Stein wants to create a population to serve the programs. Michael Strain, another reform conservative, has joined liberals in proposing extending federal unemployment benefits beyond the original 26 weeks, provided the unemployed keep looking for work. He has also outlined a plan to offer federal cash bonuses of thousands of dollars to jobless folks when they find a job to prevent them from giving up and, you know, and staying in the job market. Strain has also proposed billions of dollars in stimulus infrastructure spending with an eye toward boosting the mobility of low-income folks. He wants government to buy buses and run express lines to take low-income people to jobs. Both Ramesh and Rehan have recommended enhanced wage subsidies or expanding the earned income tax credit as the Republican alternative to higher minimum wages by Democrats. Room to Grow recommends voucherizing not only K-12 but also Head Start, the federal pre-K program for low-income kids that has failed miserably. But it is one thing to voucherize an entrenched system like K-12. It is quite another to entrench a questionable program by voucherizing it. There might be good sense in embracing some of these ideas, and they may not constitute a New Deal type expansion of big government, but they are a rather massive welfare expansion by lots of many, many, many government programs. So why are reform conservatives pushing this agenda? There is a political reason and there's a socio-cultural reason. I'll need two more minutes. I'm wrapping this up in a few minutes. On the political front, reform conservatives believe that the GOP needs to rebrand itself to stop coming across merely as pro-business party and rich folks party. They feel that liberals have a corner on the low income and the yuppie market, and they want to go for the middle income voters. Now, I would highly recommend William Vogley's essay in the Claremont Review, pointing out the flaws in this kind of political reasoning with this liberal light solutions, because he says this will fracture the conservative coalition, costing Republicans far more ideological voters than gaining them bread and butter middle class voters. He has a very nice way of putting it, and I'll just read you this quote very quickly. The core conservative argument to voters would become that our 5-point proposals for dealing with this or that social need and concerns are bounded, decentralized, and nimble, while liberals' 8-point proposals are bloated, intrusive, and ineffective. Even if completely true, that declaration doesn't rank with give me liberty or give me death. Let me briefly address the socio-cultural objective at the heart of the reform conservative proposal that actually Yuval Levin has written about extremely powerfully, and I really would urge you to read some of his essays on it because they are very thought-provoking. He suggests that the most important public policy challenge in America is strengthening civil society, or mediating institutions, as he calls them, by reversing the breakdown of families and the decline of communities, he thinks is the number one problem in America, and we all agree with that. Mediating institutions, he says, occupy the space between the individual and the state, and this space needs to be expanded because this is where the most important stuff of life happens. Also, this is the space that's a bulwark against despotism or anarchy. These institutions are the repositories of bourgeois virtue, and true liberty requires virtue. In other words, the reform conservative project, as I understand it, is virtue politics with a twist in that the government does not try and promote virtue by controlling individual behavior by, say, banning drinking or other things. Rather, it works indirectly by strengthening those institutions that cultivate virtue through such things as tax credits that make raising families easier or wage supports that incentivize work. This is what Yuval Levin calls is the long road to liberty. But the question is whether a civil society that is paid for by the government can really be a bulwark against government. Indeed, can families and workers that are propped up by the state really have the spirit of fierce self-reliance that makes them an independent force in politics? Yuval is right when he argues that true liberty needs virtue, but it is also true that virtue needs liberty. Indeed, unfettered individuals that take charge of their own destiny and care for their families and communities through their grit and sweat develop the strength of character to resist the state. But if the state takes the edge off their responsibilities with a little voucher here and a little tax credit there, as a matter of ongoing policy, not in special circumstances when they are facing unexpected adversity, will they still have the inner wherewithal to resist its overtures? Or will they over time simply succumb and expect more, as Tocqueville feared? How many universities in America reject government aid? Reform conservatives believe that they can do welfare right by setting up a non-technocratic, incentive-based system that can escape the pathologies of dependence and breakdown that have bedeviled the liberal welfare state. But the founders wrote a constitution with a government of limited and enumerated powers. This can hardly be what they had in mind. But the danger is that regardless of whether reform conservatives succeed or fail, they'll forfeit the political space for making the case for the founders' vision.
never found that cowboy hat. You know, darn. You know, now that we live in the age where Donald Trump has legitimized political incorrectness, I wanted to bring a cowboy hat, couldn't fit in my luggage, so I could put it on and say, you know, I've always wanted to be a cowboy between two Indians. I wasn't sure that one would work. And incidentally, Hillsdale College is the only college campus where you could get away with saying that without being hauled off the stockades today, right? There we go. You must be from the University of Colorado, where I did almost get hauled off the stockades during my year as an inmate at Boulder. The subject reminds me of a story many years ago out of Michigan, coincidentally, the home state of Hillsdale College, where a bill was being hotly debated in the state legislature, and a state senator was quoted as saying, quote, some of my friends are for this bill, and some of my friends are against this bill, and I'm going to stick with my friends. That's how I feel about my position on reform conservatism, or at least the debate that's erupted over it, because I have good friends on both sides. I should declare interest, as is the fashion these days. I am a recent author for a position paper for the Conservative Reform Network, which is the most organized effort of reform conservatism on energy and environmental policy. And sure enough, when the news got out that I had written the paper, one very good friend of mine sent me a worried email saying, please, please don't go all reformicon on us, right? So that the excitement over this and the controversy is really quite striking in a certain way. But one of the things I learned by participating in one of the summits of the Conservative Reform Network is there is no party line. No one asked me to sign a creedal statement, and in fact, I was maybe not entirely surprised, but pleased to see a very vigorous disagreement within the reformicon community on a number of issues that reform conservatives have been talking about, especially over tax policy and certain other things that have been mentioned here this morning. And now, I think there have always been strong policy disagreements among conservatives. Just think, for example, going back at least 20, 30 years, if not longer, heated controversies about education reform, for example, about what kind of voucher system or school choice system should work. Are charter schools a good idea or not, and how, and so on. And so, in one respect, this is not entirely new, what we're seeing. But I think that reform conservatism has taken its place alongside neoconservatism. I mean, arguably, the neoconservatives, as Shikha made reference to them, they were the reform conservatives of the 1970s. And that's a controversial term, generally and among conservatives, right? The general suspicion about reform conservatives, which Shikha laid out very well, has also been applied over the years to many neoconservatives, namely that they're insufficiently hostile to government. I think the only thing that could make this whole subject more heated is if Donald Trump suddenly came out for or against reform conservatives. It wouldn't matter, right? I see little risk of that occurring, by the way. Shikha's colleague Nick Gillespie, the editor of Reason magazine, ambushed Trump here about a week ago and said, Mr. Trump, what do you think of libertarianism? He says, oh, great stuff. Lots of good stuff there. And he keeps walks on. And Nick wasn't able to follow up. I can't wait for someone to ask for his hot take on Zoroastrianism at one of these appearances. Oh, great stuff, right? Shikha mentioned Ben Domenech from the Heartland Institute. And I should mention that Shikha edited a really excellent sort of pro and con on reform conservatism in Reason magazine, which is available online. I recommend that you all read it, because Yuval Levin is there. And then Ben, this is a quote from the article there. Ben doesn't like it. To say he's a skeptic would be understating it. He says reform conservatism is an attempt to, quote, offer a coherent and inspirational case for what are effectively a series of dry public policy white papers. Well, that doesn't sound too strong. But then his sequel was, it's little more than identity politics for white folks. Well, now we're talking. You know, in one respect, I think this debate is not really new, as I was saying. I think if you step back a little bit, reminds me of the long-running debate that goes back at least to the 1950s between libertarianism and traditional conservatism. But it becomes more acute. You know, it was all a theoretical debate for years in the pages of Modern Age or Reason Magazine or National Review and so forth. But the debate becomes more acute when you have the prospect of actual political power and responsibility. Then it's no longer a theoretical debate. I've always thought this debate, both in its larger theoretical sense and in its practical sense, is a sign of political health. It turns out that the left really doesn't have these kinds of theoretical or practical arguments. They seldom expend a lot of energy arguing over the fine points of policy changes, because the left is generally happy with any result that results in expanded power and control over people and resources. As long as you're on, to use their favorite slogan, the right side of history, they're pretty happy about things. Could tell some interesting stories about that, but I'm short of time. The libertarian view in a thumbnail sketch desires, as a matter of principle, not just limited government, but minimal government. And it views with varying degrees of skepticism, if not opposition, most exercises of state power. And then the thumbnail sketch of your traditional conservatives, again, these are all too simplistic, but for purposes of discussion, traditional conservatives, those of a more Burkean disposition, they're less hostile to state power for conservative purposes, like strengthening the family, but many other things that I could list that would give libertarians dyspeptic ulcers. Shikha didn't mention Nick Gillespie's comment about some of the tax proposals. He called reform conservatism, and I quote here, right-wing social engineering achieved via the tax code rather than by traditional edict, close quote. Although when he puts it like that, I kind of like the sound of it a little better. On the other hand, most traditional conservatives are no fan of the way we're being governed today and are at least as disaffected with the Obama era as libertarians. And also, I think many libertarians, maybe most libertarians, they have a practical political streak as well. They know that the perfect is the enemy of the good, and they know that we're not going to elect Murray Rothbard anytime soon to be president, especially since he's dead, but it appears we're not going to elect Rand Paul either. Something that may be worth discussing, why Rand Paul's candidacy, which seemed so promising a year or 2 years ago, has fizzled and gone nowhere. So why has reform conservatism struck such a nerve? I think there's three closely related reasons. One is the place of reform in our politics, or reform if you're from certain parts of the South. Look, reform is always a staple of Democratic politics, whatever place on the ideological spectrum you may be. And in the ordinary sense, it's aimed at corruption or the ineffectiveness and inefficiency of government. It usually plays well, and may still to a certain extent. But at the present time, it seems to me that conservatives and a large part of the public that is not necessarily conservative or ideological that's gravitating to Trump is less interested in reforming government than they are in taming it seriously. Or to switch metaphors, the desire is not to remodel the dysfunctional house, but to raise the interior walls completely and undergoing a radical reconstruction. I mean, I think one of the mistakes that Jeb Bush is making is saying that he wants to run for office to be a problem solver. That's not getting close to what a lot of people feel is wrong with things today. We don't want a problem solver. Or, maybe to go back to the previous term, if we're going to have a reformer, it needs to be a capital R reformer. Second, and this is the point that Bill Vogley brings up in the Claremont Review article criticizing reform conservatism that Shikha mentioned. And by the way, you probably know this, Bill Vogley is no libertarian. He's much more of a traditional conservative. So this is an interesting point that he makes. Here's the question for discussion. This will probably come up, and Ramesh will probably want to reply. Does the agenda of reform conservatism implicitly ratify what's become known as the ratchet effect? You all know what the ratchet effect is. It's every time there's a crisis or problem, government gets bigger, and that's the new baseline for government. It only gets bigger from there. I have to stop here, slide aside here. This building is a perfect example. We are today in the Ronald Reagan building. That is terrific. It's the largest federal building in downtown Washington. It houses the Environmental Protection Agency, the least Reaganite agency. You know, Bill Bennett used to talk about the education establishment as the blob that swallows everything. This is what happens. Washington says, okay, you'll name it for Ronald Reagan, great, we'll put the EPA there. And the Agency for International Development. By the way, I have to say here, I don't know if Larry is still here in the room, but you all know Larry Earn's principle of architectural constitutionalism? In one sentence, it's this. So you drive around Washington, and you can tell whether an agency is constitutional or not by looking at the building, right? If it's a classical old Romanesque building, it's probably constitutional. If it's one of these ugly modern buildings, it's unconstitutional. This building's mostly a Romanesque building in confounds. the Arn principle. So I'll give you the Hayward corollary to the Arn principle, which is semantic. Take the name of any federal agency and or its stated mission, and you can assume that its results are the opposite. You know, here in this building is the Agency for International Development, which mostly retards international development. The EPA gave us things like the King River spill here a couple weeks ago. The Equal Employment Opportunity Commission is fiercely dedicated to the idea of inequality. That's on the sort of on the negative side of the balance sheet. On the positive side of the balance sheet, and I think Shikha brought this up, and I think there are a lot in all these talks, the importance of mediating institutions, you know, those private churches, Boy Scouts, and so on, are very important and have been steadily eroding for decades. In fact, you know, thinking about the Boy Scouts, thinking about bakeries who bake wedding cakes, not exactly a mediating institution, but not exactly Howard Johnson's Motel 6 on the highway, like in the old Civil Rights Act. I wonder if one of the unintended consequences, or maybe intended consequences, of the gay marriage decision is the further erosion of mediating institutions. What's going to happen to churches that won't perform gay weddings, right? It is a curious thing to me, ironic thing to me, that some of the best scholarly work done on this problem is by a liberal, Robert Putnam at Harvard, going back to his Bowling Alone book of 15 years ago. And the difficulty, I think, with reform conservatism, and again, you know, the devil's in the details, so maybe there are good answers to this, but if you think back to an episode from the Clinton years, maybe many of you will remember this, it was midnight basketball. I'm sorry, whatever happened to midnight basketball? Well, if anything happened to it, it's because it became a federal program, right? You know, the story was a black preacher, I think, in Philadelphia thought one way to keep poor kids out of gangs is to have them play basketball at midnight. Great idea. What Washington say? Let's make it a federal program. No, don't make it a federal program. That's a way to completely screw up the idea, and I have never heard of it since, so I don't know if they ever did it or not, but that's an example of how government support for a good idea is probably a bad idea, or very difficult to make work out. Third and finally here, I think even the good ideas of reform conservatism, and I think some of the disquiet about it, is that it may not get to the heart of the problem. It may not actually be bold enough. And the heart of the problem, for lack of a better term, I'm going to call political culture. And I'll illustrate it this way. We're here in Washington, and we talk about Washington bureaucracy and centralization a lot, very important problems. On the other hand, you all heard the old story about it's an apocryphal story, usually told about Bertrand Russell, the philosopher, and the woman gets up and says, Mr. Russell, your theories of cosmology are all wrong. The world is just balanced on the back of a giant turtle. And he says, well, what's the turtle standing on? She says, you're a very clever young man, but that turtle's on another turtle. It's turtles all the way down. Right? It's the theory of infinite regress. I think that the bureaucratic turtles in America now go all the way down to the lowest level of government. I'm out of Washington now. I'm out in California studying local government more than I used to. I have pins on a map of all the local cities that have shut down little kids' lemonade stands around the country. We're up to about 40. Reason's done some of the best work on this. Look, the number of little kids' lemonade stands that should be shut down should be zero, except for some extraordinary case like a kid foolishly sets it up at a median of a busy boulevard, but doesn't seem to be the case in any of these. I would bet, by the way, that some of those suburban towns where this has happened have Republican city councils that have allowed this to happen. Seattle has recently hired trash inspectors. They're now going around and inspecting to make sure you've separated your recycling and your composting and your standard trash, and if you haven't done it right, they have the power to fine you. Now, there's no trash crisis, there's no landfill problem, there's no reason for this at all other than authoritarian leftism wanting to boss people around. Washington's not causing that. That is self-generated at the local level. That's the culture of bureaucratic government going all the way down. I'm following very closely the EPA's Clean Power Plan, which is this global warming thing. Essentially, it represents nationalizing the nation's electric utility industry. It's really much more sweeping than Obamacare and the healthcare industry. No one quite realizes this yet. And sure enough, they've essentially said, if you like your utility rates, you can keep your utility rates. My favorite part of it. Going off the Seattle example, I don't think we're very many years away from having the local government nannies, there's great enthusiasm for this in a lot of local governments, to be monitoring your energy use in your home. Have you put twisty bulbs into everything? Do you have smart meters to turn on and off your air conditioning? Even though there's no shortage of energy. I mean, in the 70s, we thought we were short of energy because we were idiots, but we know now that's wrong. That's not a problem. So what's this about? Well, it's going to be ideologically driven, right? This kind of problem is difficult to get at by mere policy reforms, as good and useful as many of them are. I'll end with this. I'm like Larry Arndt, I am somewhat optimistic. I wonder if we've gotten wiser. I mean, I think there's pretty wide agreement, including among, I think, most reform conservatives, that President George W. Bush's compassionate conservatism didn't really work very well, wasn't very well conceived. You can point to particular ideas they try to embed in Medicare Part D to employ markets, some decent education reform ideas in No Child Left Behind, but on the whole, those I think have to be reckoned defeats. And then, of course, from compassionate conservatism, there was no sort of good public argument to try and change the public mind about why you wanted to move in those directions. I think also, Reagan's been invoked several times, I think if there is, and I know not a partisan group, and I think thinkers shouldn't necessarily think in these ways, but I think that if we think there's going to be a Republican administration in 15 months, one of the things really worth doing is going back to the Reagan era and looking at their defeats, the things that they were unsuccessful at, the mistakes they made, and they made a lot of them. Shikha mentioned Social Security. That's a longer, more complicated story, but they made some crucial mistakes early on that should not be repeated. And, my book, it was mentioned, Matt kindly mentioned, it's called The Conservative Counter-Revolution. It ends by saying why it was unsuccessful in certain important and ultimately constitutional ways. And I took a lot of heat for my conclusion from people who thought you should only celebrate Reagan 100% because he was great. Of course, that's what I think too, but I think it's a mistake not to look seriously and honestly at those mistakes and realize that some of what's required is not just good policy ideas, but an attitude of trench warfare. Winston Churchill used to say, and World War II started, I want unconventional personalities running agencies and ministries. I think that's one thing that needs to be the attitude of a next conservative president. In the Reagan era, you could always figure out where the fights were going to be. It was always going to be in the appointees that Democrats opposed and tried to not confirm. Those are the people who made fights. The other people, I won't mention names, you sort of remember some of them, they're famous names, who were sort of acclaimed by the Washington establishment, posed no threat to the bureaucracy. I always said that your first rule of personnel management, and this should be a reform conservative idea at least, maybe not a position paper, is you want people who are mean as junkyard dogs and then take their dog food bowl away from them before you send them into their offices. And if you do that, you might have some chance of making some serious changes, but it's going to take that kind of attitude. So I think I'll stop there, and we've laid out a lot of things here and see where we might go. Thanks.
Great, thank you. We have some time before our break. If there is a quick comment, I know, Ramesh, do you have something you want to add, or can we go to questions?
I have about a billion things I'd like to
add. Or answer in the midst of questions. No?
Yeah. Well, let me just, the late Father Richard John Newhouse was once writing about some of the new atheists and their various screeds. And he said, let me say at the outset that I don't believe in the God in which they don't believe either. And I felt that way a lot while listening to Shikha especially explain the core of the beliefs that I supposedly hold, which I don't think either I or any of the other conservatives mentioned hold. Rather than go point by point, I will just stipulate to both Shikha and Stephen's comments about Bill Voegeli as an arbiter of this debate. His essay, which both of them recommended in the Claremont Review of Books, is indeed very much worth reading, and I suppose it's appropriate in this academic setting that we're giving you homework. I will simply quote Bill Voegeli's response to the letters that Pete Wehner and I wrote in to Claremont in response to that essay, which is being described as this harsh criticism of us. Here's Bill. Our disagreements on the substantive questions are smaller than our agreements.
The Reform conservatives want what all conservatives want: proposals, arguments, rhetoric, and candidates that will help a conservative coalition to cohere, win elections, and govern successfully. The Reform conservatives deserve great credit for their serious, thoughtful suggestions about how to bring conservatism closer to that goal. Other approaches are possible, but I'm not aware of a superior alternative out there that is currently available. I'll just rest by noting that I can handle criticism like that all day long.
All right. So with that, I think let's go ahead and open up. There are microphones some of our students have. If you would use those to ask your questions so we can direct them either to generally to the panel or to an individual. Questions? Someone right here in the front.
Thank you for the presentation. I would consider myself not to be a reform conservative, but an adherence conservative. You know, it seems like our politicians spend more time in divisive dispute over how to get around the Constitution rather than adhere to it. If we would just remember the pledge that we take, like when we start our meetings, Pledge of Allegiance, and the oath of office we take when we go into the military and some of the government agencies that we've worked for, and adhere to the principles of the Constitution rather than try to get around them to affect what are the kind of programs we want. I don't need to reform the Constitution. I need people that are willing to stand up, abide by it, and abide by the oath that they took when they said that I will protect, defend the Constitution of the United States and adhere to it and structure life accordingly. So how would you respond to that? I mean, we keep talking. It seems like we're having agency after agency rise up and almost make a living out of these conversations about how we need to reform, how we need to cohabitate in our reformations, rather than why don't we just stick with the Constitution as it was written? It isn't a toolbox with full of tools to be pulled out at whim to construct whatever programs. It's an overriding document that gives an architectural design by the architect himself.
You know, it sounds like a very good idea to me. The only problem with the suggestion is that along with the oath to respect the Constitution, the president also takes an oath to enforce the laws of the land, and the two are often in tension, and that tension has to be reconciled somehow. You know, actually, Ramesh wrote a wonderful concluding essay in Room to Grow where he said something along the lines of what you're suggesting, which is that, you know, we cannot simply rely on the courts to keep our laws in check and not intrude on the Constitution. We need a certain kind of political constitutionalism. Courts are too bogged down with considerations of stare decisis and, you know, what have you, but lawmakers don't have such constraints, so they can impose on themselves a stricter understanding of the Constitution than the court, in fact, can enforce. And there's a lot to what Ramesh says. The problem only is that, you know, at the same time as Republicans are proposing bills to give massive child credits to parents, how can they at the same time also impose these limits on themselves? So there is this tension which is built into our system. There is a tension in the oath of office that the president takes, and that same tension is actually apparent in reform conservatism too, I think.
I'll make one brief comment, talk all day about this. I wish we had more robust constitutional discourse by our political class. Now, that's not simple to do, because actually I think an awful lot of voters in the world, citizens, you know, they don't follow abstractions very well. So if it's just on the level of abstraction, it doesn't really work. But the lack of that results in something like this. I thought the very worst moment, maybe, of the George W. Bush presidency was the day he signed the McCain-Feingold campaign finance bill. And in the course of signing, it says, I believe this bill is unconstitutional. By the way, the next sentence should have been, therefore, I'm following my constitutional duty and vetoing it. He takes an oath of office to defend the Constitution. Instead, what he said is, but this is an issue for the Supreme Court. No, that's completely wrong. You have to go to a Hillsdale class to learn all the reasons why and how to talk about that. But, you know, the lack of sort of serious thinking about and then, you know, just make people talk seriously about the Constitution leads to moments like that that are very destructive of our sort of constitutional order, I think.
Ramesh, you want to add to that? Or?
I'll just say, I don't think that the question, can we limit government and simultaneously provide tax relief to parents, is a particularly difficult one. If you look at probably the modern peak of libertarian practical influence on the Republican Party, it's the contract with America, the 1994 document whereby the Republicans helped to take control of the House of Representatives for the first time in 40 years and try to prosecute an agenda of getting rid of cabinet departments and limiting government with mixed success. They did, in fact, get spending cuts. And lo and behold, the contract with America includes, let's put a child credit into the American tax code. Let's offset the federal government's bias against families. It was not a huge problem then. I don't think actually Reason even made a big deal about it then. I don't see why providing tax relief, even for Bill Gates, is so incompatible with limited government. It seems to me to actually follow from it fairly simply.
Very quickly.
You know, it is one thing, it is one thing to offer payroll tax relief as a general, you know, to everybody. We are going to cut payroll taxes. This is your money. Keep it back. This is for you. It is quite another thing to play favorites with the payroll tax as we do with the general income tax code. The two are quite different things. Look, there is actually a respectable case to be made for child credits. I mean, the respectable case is, even against payroll taxes, that this is the only way, as Steve mentioned, libertarians do have a practical streak. They do believe that, you know, you have to get through the political process to get to where you want. I mean, and the respectable political case for child credits would be, look, we live in a world where Democrats exist. They win elections on a regular basis. What we have to do, we cannot talk them into giving us just general tax cuts. So we will put them on the defensive by forcing them to say no to child credits. So let's give child credits as a way of then having a conversation about scaling back the giant entitlement programs that are supported by the payroll taxes. What you can't have is give a payroll tax cut for parents at the same time say we are doing this for the health of Social Security and Medicare. We want to make sure that these programs exist for future generations. That matters. Does not work, in my view.
So I would just point out real quick that despite the policy disagreements, there's actually an agreement here on a general constitutional point, which is that adherence to the Constitution is a good thing, but we should make a practice of trying to get out of the narrow legalisms of the courts into a broader legislative constitutionalism so that legislators, reflecting the consent of the American people, can grapple with these hard questions in a way that is compatible with the Constitution, despite your policy disagreements. Yes, sir.
Could we start a conversation on what to do about Obamacare, Medicare, and how the Reform conservatives, I believe David Frum did something on that a number of years ago. By the way, that's one name I haven't heard mentioned here about reform. I assume he's a reform conservative, is that?
I think David is a Frum conservative.
he's his own. no one claims him.
Before he's anything else. Reform conservatives have spent a lot of time on health care over the last few years, and the basic argument is that we don't just need to repeal Obamacare, but we also need to deal with the problems that misguided federal interventions had been creating in our health care system for decades, and we need to create a new system in which federal spending, regulation, and tax policy does a lot less than it has for decades to shape the health insurance market. We believe that should take the form of reforming Medicare along the lines that Paul Ryan has suggested, that it is a competitive, consumer-driven market, that Medicaid should, for the most part, be just cashed out and given to people so that they can buy insurance in the regular health market rather than being sort of ghettoized in this incredibly substandard health insurance market, that people ought to be able to buy health insurance across state lines, and that the tax treatment of healthcare should be changed so that people who don't have access to employer coverage can buy insurance for themselves. Now, the result of all of this, as I said, is I think you get something that is to the right, not just of Obamacare, which is, of course, a pretty low bar, but to the right of what we've had for several decades, and we have a functional healthcare system and a marketplace. The Obamacare has always been unpopular, but I do think that voters have a lot of, or at least a significant number of voters have a lot of anxieties about what would happen if you just got rid of it. And I think you have to answer those anxieties. And I think that is a general point about the reform conservative approach, that you have to beat the sort of regulatory authoritarianism that Steve was mentioning, but you have to explain to people who are nervous that they can have all the things that the liberal welfare state promises in a better way. They can have the security of ownership rather than the security of welfare. And if we don't answer the question, those sorts of anxieties, we're not going to make any headway.
I completely agree. I have nothing to add.
We have agreement. We have agreement. Yes, sir. Mike, right here.
Very many good points made this morning, and I think absent from the discourse, though, is an emphasis on the principles that underlie our form of government and our fidelity to those principles. The tensions that are created because we have been unfaithful to those principles are many, and they are difficult, and they present varied challenging problems for us both politically, economically, and socially. So, as was discussed earlier, that we need to have a re-education, if you will, in our political class, is it not perhaps more in our social class, the people themselves? If you were to do the man on the street inquiry with average American citizen, how many would be able to express those principles of individual liberty, property rights, and rule of law? And how do we expect to sway the people and persuade them of the rightfulness or the righteousness of our political positions if they have no understanding in them?
Well, I can try to give some kind of answer to that very broad question that is almost impossible to answer. There are no gimmicks for this, although I suppose I should do a commercial for Hillsdale College's online constitution. But I'm you know, more than halfway serious about that. How many hundreds of thousands of people have signed up, right? I will try and give one answer here, but here's an example of the difficulty. So some of our friends at various states and in Congress, you know, there's a federal law that says that any institution of higher education, meaning other than Hillsdale that takes federal funds, has to do some kind of observance of Constitution Day. So in 2 days from now, almost every college around the country will have some Constitution programs. So when I'm at the University of Colorado teaching constitutional law to undergraduates, this is a great error of theirs, it's a funny story. They handed me the car keys to a really important course and I made them regret it. But, you know, the department chair, oh, gee, we want to do our official Constitution Day celebration, said, what, in a class on constitutional law? Isn't this something wrong with this picture, right? And I said, by the way, I think that law's unconstitutional. I said, just be fine. Told that to the class. But what was the program? It was two law professors from the law school who came in and did the usual liberal rot. And that's what happened. So, you know, so that kind of gimmick doesn't work. That's a lot to that story. So what does work, in addition to serious educational programs like the aforementioned one, you know, we do need a class of leaders who learn to talk about this again. And again, that's not simple to do, but I think that's what's necessary. And You know, I mean, I don't know. Larry's still here. You know, but I'm hoping Hugh Hewitt tomorrow night might try and uncork a question about the Constitution and see how somebody handles it. It may or may not. You know, I'm sure he's thought through it. He's going to do very well. It's going to be fun to watch. But you know, citizens should ask about that. And I have a lot more thoughts about this, but you know, I don't want to go on all day about it.
If I could just add to that point, and I think this will be another point of agreement among us. Part of the problem is the over-reliance on the courts as constitutional enforcers that's been mentioned here. I think it's caused our constitutional muscles to atrophy. We just assume that they'll take care of that. That's sort of the province of lawyers. And we have to get used over time to strengthening and rebuilding those muscles. Oh, another point of agreement, having been in a car with Steve Hayward, giving him the keys is indeed a reckless act.
I would just add one thing. Please read Reason magazine on a regular basis. I think it's one of the few publications that, you know, adheres and advocates for the principles of the Constitution in an almost uncompromising and diluted way than pretty much any other publication out there, in my view.
I think the question, and Steve has already alluded to this, really goes to the heart of the matter, which is that what we've established is that constitutionalism is less a technical art and more a way of thinking. And to shape a way of thinking, you have to teach people. And you have to teach them the fundamental principles in clear ways that they understand and can comprehend, but those are still abstractions. And it's only when they apply those ideas that they become truly meaningful. But the way you do that must be through practice and experience. We face grave challenges today, grave challenges. But I have no doubt that with people well taught, able to think, and think these things through, we can have the types of individuals to solve these problems. I think of James Madison, trying to solve the problems of the Constitution. A very practical man, very learned, like Washington, understood the principles of the founding deeply in his heart, understood them because he sat around and had dinner with Jefferson and Madison and all the gang. But he was also very practical and understood the necessities of politics, but also what to do in order to achieve those larger objectives. This has been a great panel. We're going to take a short 15-minute coffee break and reconvene to talk about another very difficult and vexing question, the future of marriage in America. Thank you.
How's that?